my name is Brittany Aliani. I am the manager of the Sage Medical Library here at Cottage Health. You see those credentialing behind my name, that's a master's in library science, and then AHIP is the Academy of Health Information Professionals, which is an additional credentialing to make sure that I know what I'm doing and that I can talk to you tonight. So my background is I did my training at Mayo Clinic. I was there for 8 years. From there, I went to Johns Hopkins, and I was there for 6 years, and then Cottage recruited me, and now you guys get to have this talk. This is my email, so if you have any questions about anything I've talked about tonight, and maybe you went home and you said, oh, I forgot to ask Brittany that, you are more than welcome to email me, and I will be more than happy to answer those questions. In addition, if this is interactive, so if I'm talking about something, feel free. Jessica's here. She'll be going around with the microphone, and she'll be more than happy to answer any questions that you guys have. So please, feel free to shout out, but we also will have a question and answer afterwards. I also want to make a disclosure. We are here to give you information, to give you tools of how to assess what you find on the internet. By no means are we telling you this is a good website, this isn't a good website, although we are going to show you some of our favorites. What we're doing is for you to be able to go onto the internet and really critically think, is this good? What they're telling me, is this something I should take as fact? Or is it fiction? Okay, so we've got some learning objectives here. We're gonna help you find how to assess an authoritative website and what that looks like. We're gonna show you what it means for your doctor to be board certified or have a medical license, and what does that mean? We're also gonna look at information on social media. That's a big thing right now. I'm sure anyone who's on any kind of social media site right now has probably been faced by a friend either sharing a post or something about health information. And how do you assess whether that's accurate? Is that good what they're sharing, or are they just kind of going on an algorithm and it's just getting spread all over? And then we're also gonna look at alternative and complementary medicine, because that is a big part of medicine these days. And what we want you to do is, if you are going to use CAM, as it's called, that you're able to look up authoritative websites to question any kind of complementary therapy. Okay, so here we go. Librarians love to give statistics because we think that helps us when we're teaching you something. So a study was done, and 20% of respondents said the internet is their first source of looking up health information. Who has a smartphone right now? Does everybody have a smartphone? I bet you someone, everyone who has that phone has probably looked up something. I have an odd rash. What is that? So what do? You Google it. So then we have 30% of respondents use the internet or mobile apps to shop for healthcare. Healthcare business is a really big thing right now. So everybody's going around and they're looking all that stuff up. So the statistics are showing us that, again, people are looking on the internet for health information. 39% of comparison shoppers said the process prompted them to change their healthcare facility. So again, people are looking up their hospitals. They're seeing what is out there. Here's another issue that happens, that we find people come to us all the time. Are you guys ever faced that you go to your physician and they tell you, you have an itis of this, or we're gonna do an ectomy of this, and you're thinking, I have no idea what they are saying. Or they give you health information, like, here's your discharge orders, this is what you do when you go home, and you read those discharge orders, and you think, again, I don't know what this stuff is saying. Well, the National Library of Medicine, which, by the way, is the largest medical library in the world, it's attached to the NIH, they have this amazing website, which is called What Did My Doctor Say? And you can go on there, and they have an alphabetized list of medical terminology that you can go on there and you click it. It's like, what is an appendectomy? What does it mean with itis is behind a word? And that's really helpful for you. And we try to make the list, and Heather and I realize that it's so long that to give you a pamphlet on that would be 40 pages. So what we're doing is we're giving you the link to that, and that is available to you on the handout that we gave you. Medical board licensing. That's some good stuff to talk about. So what does it mean when your doctor is board certified? It means that they've gone through ABMS, that's the American Board of Medical Specialties, and they've done either a written test or an oral test, and they're required to maintain that every, depending on the specialty, either 5 to 10 years. And that means that they are specialized in their area of practice. Every doctor at Cottage Health is required to be board certified. I want to make this distinction. Every doctor is required to have a medical license. They're not required to be board certified all the time. So your doctor could be licensed to practice in California, but they may not be board certified. So what's great about this is it demonstrates when you're that exceptional person, they've gone out, they've done extra CMEs, they've gone on to done extra testing. I will tell you every year, we know it's board certification for our OBGYNs because we get little emails saying, it's that time of year, I need to read my 20 articles. Can the library provide that for us? And we do. Also, for board certification, this is how we credential at Cottage Health. So when a new physician comes on board here, we will ask them, we need to see your certificate for board certification, and our credentialing office will look into that. They will go and contact ABMS, they'll look up their license, they'll see their board certification, where they went to school, do they have any issues, and then that all happens before a physician gets credentialed. So I wanna say, look, it's 880,000 specialties that are on ABMS. So you can also look if you have an acupuncturist, you can go on there, and if you have a DO. So they don't just do MDs, they do many specialties on there. So if you're looking for one of your specialists, it's a really good idea to try to go on ABMS. And of course, you know I'm gonna give you an example of what it looks like. So I already talked about that they're verified, the specialist. So I'm not gonna go really into this slide, I'm gonna keep moving. Okay, so here we go, licensing. So as you can see here, this is Dr. Freed. Does anyone know who Dr. Freed is? He's one of our critical care intensivists. And so this is what his medical license looks. And I will tell you, every state, so if you move from California or you're just here visiting this time of the year, but you're going back to, let's say, Wisconsin, or you're going back to Arizona, there is a medical board in every single state in the United States. And I'll also tell you, the information is shared. So if you get in trouble here in California, it's gonna get shared in Arizona and Wisconsin. So here's Dr. Freed. As you can see, his license renewed and current. It tells you that he went to medical school at the University of Southern California, what year he graduated. And right now you can see it's looking pretty good. This is what comes up when you go on Dr. Freed. As you can see here, no information. So they are gonna look at all these different areas here. Does he have probationary? Does he have malpractice issues? They're gonna, in detail, look at that. And as you can see, I'm happy to report, Dr. Freed looks pretty good, doesn't he? So thank God, way to go, Dr. Freed. And this is all public information, by the way. So I'm not giving you guys any secrets here. In fact, I talked to him today and I'm like, I'm using you as an example. And he's like, how did you get my medical license? And I said, it's public information. But we're using you as a good doctor. And he's like, okay, then that's fine. Okay, you can go ahead and use me as an example. So Dr. Freed, what did I say a couple minutes ago? All our doctors are required to be board certified. So he's also board certified in internal medicine and critical care and pulmonary medicine. So Dr. Freed is board certified in 3 specialty areas, which means he had to test in all 3 specialty areas. So I would say we've got a pretty good doctor if you're in the MICU here at Cottage Health. So what does it look like when you're in trouble? Does anybody know who the Candyman is? You guys remember the Candyman? Yeah, the Candyman is in trouble. He's spending 27 years in federal prison. Does anybody know why the candy? I mean, the words in the Candyman. We're having an opioid crisis, yes? That's what he was doing. He was dispensing a lot of narcotics to people in Santa Barbara. And I don't know if you guys are aware of, every single medical practitioner has what's called a DEA number. So every time that physician is writing a prescription for a narcotic, the DEA is tracking that. They're looking at it and they're thinking, why is an internal medicine doctor prescribing all these narcotics, their internal medicine? As opposed to if it was a pain specialist, then they might look at it but think, oh, well, it makes sense. It's a pain doctor, but even they aren't prescribing opioids anymore. And so Julio Diaz got in a little bit of trouble. Here's the actual court case. Does anybody recognize that lady's name up at top? She's could be a little familiar, maybe in the news lately. It's Kamala, yeah. She was the actual attorney that was prosecuting him. And so you can see here, here we go, here's the court decision and order for Mr. Diaz. And you can see here on the thing, it says, the Medical Board of California is authorized to revoke his license. It also says respondent clearly, excessively prescribed narcotic medications to a patient in violation of Business and Professions Code 725. So Kamala put the Candyman away and look at his license. What does that say? It's been revoked. So Mr. Diaz will never be practicing medicine again. But it's good to look. If you're going to go see a new doctor, you might want to look up their medical license, see what's going on there. So here we go. Here's again, here's the disciplinary actions. He had to surrender his license, and then he had a public letter of reprimand. So I don't think he's going to be practicing anyway because he's in federal prison. So, okay. Does that person look familiar? It's Michael Jackson. This is his autopsy report. Do you see what he died of? Acute propofol intoxication. So propofol, I have never heard in all my years in a clinical setting seeing someone administer propofol in someone's house. We give, Dr. Free gives propofol up in the ICU, but that person's monitored, what kind of medication they're giving, all that stuff is very detailed. They're right in that area. There's a crash cart there. If anything goes wrong with someone taking propofol, trust me, we're gonna take care of it, not at someone's home. So here you go, autopsy report. Cause of death, acute propofol intoxication. Indicates that propofol and benzodiazepines were administered by another. The propofol was administered in a non-hospital setting without any appropriate medical indicators. It's pretty sad. So, who's this person? That's Michael Jackson's doctor. His name was Conrad Murray. He had to surrender his license. I will tell you, I've been following this for a couple years because I used to talk about him when he was at Johns Hopkins. Before he was indicted, they actually put a ban on his license, and the ban was you could still practice medicine, but you couldn't administer propofol, and that's what it used to say. But he's now since gone to jail for 4 years. We're going to see in a minute that he was convicted of manslaughter. So, but he did have to surrender his license there. And here you go. Here's some of the actions here. He had involuntary manslaughter. He did spend 4 years. His license is now revoked. He doesn't have a medical license. And I will tell you, Kamala also prosecuted that case. So that was a lot of heavy stuff to talk to you about, right? So let's talk about Google. Everybody likes to talk about Google. So why do I want to talk about Google? And it's because that's typically what we all do when we're searching for health information. We just go into that magic box and we put over whatever we're looking, and all these results come up. So if you look here, we've got diabetes, 749,000 results. That's a lot of information to go through. Oh, billion, you're right. Then we've got 1.8 billion for cancer. So then we have heart attack. Look at all those results. How do you go through all that information and decide what's good, what's bad? And that's ultimately what we're going to talk to you about tonight, aside from looking up your doctor's medical license. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is Medline Plus. This is an amazing website. It is produced and run by the National Library of Medicine, which is on the NIH campus. And it literally has thousands of librarians that and physicians and peer-reviewed experts that are looking at this website all the time. And so what Medline Plus does, in one area, it houses all the experts. So you don't have to keep crossing over, going into one website to the other. So let's say you were looking up diabetes and you wanted information on that. What Medline Plus does is, in one area, you're going to get information from the American Diabetes Association, from the CDC, you're going to get something from Mayo Clinic, and so it's all there in this great area for you to find it, and it's updated on a daily basis. So we have a little video to talk about Medline Plus.
Welcome to Medline Plus, the consumer health information website from the National Library of Medicine and the National Institutes of Health. You can use Medline Plus to find free, reliable information to help you make informed healthcare decisions. Medline Plus is available in English and Spanish, and you can use it on any device. Medline Plus has close to 1,000 health topics. You can find health topics by the body location, by category, or by the alphabetical index. Here's the health topic page on back pain. On this page, you can find all types of information about back pain. A great place to start is the summary. Medline Plus also offers information on drugs and supplements. The drugs and supplements page has two sections, drugs and herbs and supplements. You can find drugs alphabetically by name using the index. Drugs are listed by both their brand and generic name. Medline Plus also has videos and tools. You can check out videos on health topics, watch surgical procedures, explore health check tools, and play games. Still looking for more? You can always search Medline Plus using the search box. Or from the homepage, you'll find links to other resources from the National Library of Medicine, such as clinicaltrials.gov. You can also find the latest health news, browse the Medline Plus magazine, or sign up for email updates. If you enjoy using Medline Plus, share it with your colleagues, family, and friends. Medline Plus, trusted health information for you.
Okay, so did you see on there where it said, look at today's news? That's one of the best features of Medline Plus. So if you're watching the evening news, and it says, study shows that 5 out of 10 people will develop shingles by the time they're 65. That whole health news area that we just showed you, they're keeping track of that. And so that way you can kind of vet when you hear things or you read something in the, let's say, the news press, and you say, well, where does that information come from? Most likely, the National Library of Medicine is keeping track of that, and they're going to link you to what the reliable information is, and they're going to tell you whether it's legitimate or not. I could go on and on about the amazing things. I truly believe that this, by far, is one of the best consumer health websites out there because they really get all the experts. They also have multiple languages. You can do both Spanish and English. There's a button at top. So you can kind of see over there, it says Espanol in the far right-hand corner. You just click that and literally the page will flip and it will all be in Spanish, which is amazing. But you can find multiple languages on there. I think they have like something like over 50 languages on there. Now, I will say, of course, they can't have every disease and disorder in every language because that would be virtually impossible. But most likely diabetes, they're going to have that in a lot of languages because that's a disease that affects a lot of people worldwide. So here you go. It's flu season. So let's say that I wanted to go on Medline Plus because I'm concerned about flu season. you can go on the box, you can put in flu season. And when I say that I don't think there's ever gonna be a website that is comprehensive as this, if you look on the screen here, look at all this information and look where it's coming from. So you have the Centers for Disease Control, the National Library of Medicine, the American Academy of Physicians. So that's what they're doing. They're pulling all the information from these individual institutions and they're putting it in a one-stop shop area, which is really nice. So you can have prevention, your diagnosis, your symptoms. They also have, if you're looking for related information, like I want a support group or I want to find out where the association is for this disease or disorder, they will have links to that. And they also have links that are in your area. So if you're, again, just visiting Santa Barbara, but you're going back to your home in Wisconsin, you can say what are the support groups in this area? And you can link to that in that area. And again, you see that I did the Spanish version right on the far right. So now I'm going to talk about the Centers for Disease Control because I also think this is an amazing resource, untapped resource. Often when we're asked in the library, where do I find the statistics of how many people are vaping? Guess what? They're keeping track of that because that's really in the news right now. Anything, flu, meningitis, measles, all that stuff, they're keeping track of it. But what a lot of people don't know about the CDC, and as a little tidbit for you, because I am from Washington, D.C., the CDC is the only department that is not in Washington, D.C. Do you guys, does anyone know where it's at? Do you know why it's in Atlanta? Because in the 1940s, they had a malaria outbreak. That's why the CDC is in Atlanta. So they also have amazing travelers information. And I feel like Santa Barbara, we are a savvy group here. I think a lot of people travel outside of Santa Barbara. And I think the CDC, especially for traveling the world, is one of the best resources. So let's say I'm going to Morocco next year and I think to myself, well, do I need to get vaccinations to go to Morocco? Do they have yellow fever there? Do they have malaria there? What part should I go to? Are there traveler advisory right now? Maybe there's an outbreak and I don't know about it. You can learn that from the CDC. And they're gonna give you a breakdown of anywhere in the world and give you all the information that you would possibly need to go anywhere in the world. And I really, truly believe, so you see here, look, they've got traveler's advice, they've got traveler's notices, yellow fever vaccination notices, and they literally will go by country to tell you what areas you need to get shots for if you're not going to that area. So let's say you're going to Brazil, but maybe not the Amazon. Maybe you don't need to get a malaria preventative medication. Maybe if you're just staying, you know, in Rio, you might be okay, but they're going to tell you that. They also, those little notices I told you about, so they do green, yellow, and red. And those are giving you the health notices of whether you should be traveling there. So again, if you're thinking about, and those can change on a day to day. So I'm not saying maybe don't go somewhere because they're giving you a red notice, because that could change in a couple of weeks. Maybe they had an outbreak, but then they got it together and now it's out of green. So, but it's just, again, it's another tool for you guys to use to get really good health information. So now I'm going to introduce Heather Stevens. She's our new librarian at Sage Medical Library, and she's going to talk about alternative medicine. She's going to also look at social media and really how to assess when you're hearing health information, how do you decide what's good and what's bad?
So the first thing I'm going to talk about today are complementary and alternative medicines, okay, or CAMs. CAMs are things that are safe and helpful when they're used in conjunction with standard medical treatment. So these are things like acupuncture, okay, meditation, yoga. They can also include things like herbal remedies or supplements. There's actually a National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health, and that's a part of the Department of Health and Human Services. So what CAMs really do, they focus on kind of treating emotional, spiritual, functional, and community aspects. So they really focus on kind of the whole person rather than just one organ system, for example. All right. The NCCIH really wants us to make the distinction between complementary and alternative. They're used interchangeably, but when you go to your doctor and talk about a CAM therapy, it's really important to either say complementary or alternative, depending on your needs. So the NCCIH says if the unconventional therapy or CAM is used in conjunction with a traditional treatment, it's considered complementary. If it's used in place of or instead of, it's considered alternative. Okay, so if you go to your doctor and you say, I want acupuncture as an alternative treatment for whatever you have, that means you want this treatment instead of what your doctor is prescribing. Okay, so don't say alternative unless you really mean alternative. Okay, two big things the NCCIH wants us to know about CAMs, particularly regarding supplements. Okay, supplements and herbal treatments can actually interact with the prescription medication that you're already on. So it can sometimes make the prescription medication more potent, or it can kind of conflict and make it less effective. I'm gonna show an example in just a second. The second thing that NCCIH wants you to keep in mind is that these products can sometimes be contaminated. Okay, so especially products that are marketed for weight loss or bodybuilding or like performance enhancement, these supplements are sometimes, they contain ground up prescription medication, and then they're combined with herbal herbs and other supplements that make them more potent, okay? So you could actually be having hidden prescription medication in a supplement. Also, since there's no federal agency that can regulate every single bottle from every single brand that's sold online or in a brick and mortar store, it's really easy for a manufacturer to just swap old pills into a new bottle and slap a new expiration date on there. So you really got to be careful when looking at non-regulated supplements. Does everybody know this guy? St. John and his wort, okay? All right, so maybe you think, okay, taking some St. John's wort, that's maybe a little bit more of a low-key, easier, more chill way to help me feel better, all right? It's easier than going to the doctor, explaining all my symptoms, getting a prescription, filling the prescription. However, if you're already on prescription medication and you start taking a supplement, what do you think might happen, okay? What kinds of drugs do you think interact with St. John's wort? Okay, maybe something that, like antidepressants, since St. John's wort is kind of known for lifting your mood. Maybe antidepressants, maybe anti-anxiety medication. What about cancer drugs or cholesterol drugs or birth control? All right, so this is not, I'm not trying to like scare you and tell you, oh, never take a supplement. I'm just saying talk to your doctor first. Don't start taking anything, and certainly don't take a lot of it, okay, before checking to make sure that this is not gonna interact with something you're already taking. All right, so how do you tell if you're looking for some sort of complementary or alternative therapy? How do you tell where to go? Who's a great acupuncturist? I'm looking for acupuncture. Well, here's where the National Center of Complementary and Integrative Health comes in. You can see here their website. Just looking at some of the topics already, they're kind of providing you with more resources on these alternative therapies. I looked just to see, I was just curious, what do they say about CAMs? And their number one piece of advice, talk with your doctor, okay? Before you do anything, talk to your doctor. Your doctor's goal is to improve your health, keep you healthy, okay? So they want to work with you. Secondly, if you do decide to pursue some sort of complementary or alternative therapy, look for a national association, some sort of certification or credentialing system. Maybe you want an acupuncturist. Look for the National Certification Commission for Acupuncture and Oriental Medicine. Okay? You can find all of this on this website. It's on your handout. All right. The next big piece of advice that they give is, okay, say you find an acupuncturist using this website. Go and ask the practitioner, what are your credentials? What schooling do you have? Okay, I've only been at the hospital for a few months, but I have learned that healthcare providers love to talk about how qualified they are. So I'm sure they will be happy to tell you what's their education, what's their background, how are they qualified to do what they're about to do, okay? And then lastly, be skeptical. You know, I would love to live in a world where everybody is out to help everyone, and people who provide services are out there doing it to improve the health of others. But sadly, that's not always true. So just be skeptical, critically think, and talk with your doctor before pursuing something. All right, so maybe you've decided you don't want an acupuncturist after all. Maybe you just want to take a pill. So you're looking online and you come across some great supplements and they look like they could treat everything, okay? Before you take those wonder drugs and supplements, I'm gonna give you some red flags to look out for, okay? That maybe this product isn't all it's cracked up to be. Are there bold claims that use very sensational, attention-grabbing language? Does it also use language that's maybe a little subjective? Does it say, oh, it'll improve your performance, it'll further your game, make you feel better? What, do you measure that? How can you measure that? But if you can't measure it, it's hard to refute it, right? Next, maybe this manufacturer or advertiser is pretty smart and they know they're supposed to be relying on scientists and experts and clinical trials. So they might actually mention scientists and studies. You might see the word, this study shows. All right, I want you to ask, what study? Says who? Okay? Another thing these manufacturers will often do is rely on user reviews or testimonials to prove that they work. Okay, unfortunately, these things are also very easily faked. Okay, just because it's got 855 star reviews from people all over the world saying, oh my gosh, it makes me feel so much better, doesn't mean that 850 people love the product. Okay, it means that somebody said, I love the product. It doesn't mean they used it or that it worked. Okay, another thing, they might try to blind you with some flashy ingredients. All right, oh, it's a secret exotic ingredient that's, you know, not been available in the United States before, and that's why it's not more popular. They might also claim to do a lot of things. Okay, I've seen things that supplements that claim to make your hair thicker, you lose weight, and it lifts your mood. Okay, that's all over the place. I would love it, but sadly, if it's a cure-all, it's a cure-nothing. That's what my family doctor told me when I was a teenager. So maybe you're looking for some supplements and you come across Alpha Power. Okay, this is an actual supplement. I took this from an actual website. It's being sold by a semi-famous media personality. I'm sure some of you would recognize this name if I were to give him the plug. So using some of the tools that I just gave you, you know now the red flags to watch out for. Let's look at this product description and see, okay? See if you guys can spot anything that's maybe a little fishy, okay? First up, helps increase your energy and reduce fatigue. All right, maybe it's got caffeine in it. Okay, boost sports performance to further your game. What does that mean? Does it make me better at basketball? Okay, assist in healthy weight levels to boost your metabolism. All right, maybe caffeine, it picks up your metabolism. All right, help maintain normal high free testosterone levels. Support healthy cholesterol and blood glucose levels if you're already in the healthy range. So if you take this supplement and you're already healthy, you're gonna continue to be healthy and normal. Great. Okay, so what are you guys seeing just from the first kind of paragraph, these first set of bullet points? Are you seeing some red flags? Maybe, yeah, like what? Can you name some of them?
There's just so many different ones up there.
Yeah, right, okay, it's claiming to do a lot of stuff.
It does everything. Yeah.
Right, it's cure all. So it's really a cure nothing. Okay, let's look at the ingredients. Okay, maybe it can do all of these things. Let's check out the ingredients. Niacin and zinc. Okay, that's plausible. If you look at your bottle of vitamins that maybe your doctor recommended, you would see these ingredients. Okay, great. What about LJ100 Uricoma longifolia root extract? I've never heard of a vitamin or a mineral that sounds like it could be an airplane. LJ100, okay? All right, this kind of looks like a list of flashy ingredients to me that I have no way of verifying what they're gonna do to my body. I don't know, okay? So, if things like this are out there and they're out there in abundance, I know you're gonna come across more information than you can possibly handle on social media. I'm on social media and I'm trained to know how to look at it and I still feel overwhelmed, okay? So, this health feedback organization that is actually, it is a review board that has, it's full of doctors, researchers, health information experts. There are some librarians on here. And what they do is they evaluate healthcare information that's already out there. Okay, and they will say, yeah, this is credible, no, it's not credible. So what they did, they partnered with the Credibility Coalition. And they looked at the top 100 most shared health information articles on social media. And they do it every year. They haven't done it for 2019 yet, so that's why I'm using 2018 figures. And what they found is that 3 of the top 10 stories were found to be highly credible. Okay, so about 1 out of every 3. 4 articles were found to contain misleading information. Okay, so maybe it's not outrightly wrong, but you're not gonna walk away having the clearest idea of what you just read, okay? And then 3 were found to be not credible and potentially harmful. So let's break that down. You are just as likely to find something that's highly credible as you are to find something that's potentially harmful. All right? So there's a lot out there. How do you tell? How do you tell if what you're reading is full of crap? Well, you evaluate it for currency, relevance, authority, accuracy, and purpose. So let's look at the crap test. First of all, currency. Are you looking at something that was published within the last couple of years, or is this like something that was new in 2007 and has now become either debunked or it's become fairly verified and is kind of standard practice now? All right, if you're looking at it online, do the links still work? Okay, if you click the link, does it actually go somewhere or does it turn up, you know, 0404 or file not found, okay? Secondly, is it relevant to you? Okay, is it actually giving you information that you can apply to your life? Is it meant for a patient or a consumer? Or is this something maybe that your doctor should see instead? Or is it something for kids? All right, is it written at your level? Is it relevant to you? If not, just move on. Save your time. Next, authority. Is there even an author listed? You don't always have to have an author because a lot of times things are published by an editorial board. So it doesn't have to have an author, but that's a really good start if it does have an author. And then if it does have an author, who is this author and why are they qualified to tell me what they're telling me? Okay, what credentialing do they have? If they're not experts in health, are they citing people who are? Next, you might look at the URL. Okay, if there's not an author, but it's from the CDC, if it's from a website that ends in .gov or .edu, then that tells you a lot more about the authority of this article than if it's from a commercial website like .com. Accuracy. Okay, this is a big one. A lot of people feel kind of insecure about this one. You don't have to know whether the information is right or wrong just looking at it. Okay, but what you need to be able to do is verify what you're seeing with another source. If it's right, somebody else out there is saying it, even if the only other person who's saying it is your doctor when you ask him about it. Okay, even if it's your favorite nurse when you see her in the hallway. Has the information that you're looking at been reviewed or refereed? Is there an editorial board looking at it? Is it coming from a doctor who is pulling on years and years of evidence-based practice to tell you? And finally, what's the purpose? Why are these people putting this information in front of you? Is it to inform you? Is it to persuade you to buy something? Is it gonna persuade you to believe in something? What's their purpose? All right, you guys feel pretty good about the crap test? Okay. So, let's look at one of these articles, okay? 10 things that happen to your body if you walk every day. Right away, using the crap test, using those red flags we just talked about a few minutes ago, I can already see, maybe some things that have me scratching my head here. Okay, do you guys notice any red flags? What is bugzodiac.com? What is that? This has 600,000 shares. Has anybody ever heard of bugzodiac.com? What can you do on bugzodiac.com? You can buy stuff. Wow, I wonder if they might have any kind of hidden agenda here. All right, let's look at this article. All right, walk every day. It's cheap and effective. That sounds about right. All right, what's the first thing that happens to your body? Your brain changes, okay? It increases, it aids overall brain health and even reduce the percentage of Alzheimer's and dementia. Reduce the percentage of Alzheimer's. Can you reduce the percentage of a condition? What does that even mean? All right, what's the next thing? Enhanced vision. Walking helps me see better. Guys, I walk 10,000 steps a day at least, and I've been wearing glasses for a long time. All right, apparently, walking every day can benefit the eyes. Walking improves some eye pressure, thus reducing glaucoma in some cases. So maybe walking might reduce eye pressure in some cases. All right, but who says? Who says? Who's telling me that walking improves eye pressure? Nobody. All right, maybe they'll cite some sources. Oh, what's this? According to the American Heart Association. Great, walking is just as useful as running, according to the American Heart Association. Walking sucks, says Abraham Lincoln. All right, unless they link to the study, unless they're linking to an article that says this, I don't buy it. Larger lungs, you walk, maybe you breathe more, I don't know. There are no experts telling me. Do you think it was ranked not credible and potentially harmful? Not credible. Neutral. Credible or highly credible? What do you guys think? Not credible. Not credible. You're correct. You're excellent at this. Awesome. Yes. So the scientists over at Health Feedback found that this article was not credible. their science editor says there is no research backing up any of the claims, not even the ones that we know to be true or that might be true. Okay, you might have noticed that at a couple of different points in the article, they say things like, this study shows, the American Heart Association says, but then they don't link to anything. So they kind of throw out these little cues that make you think they're more legitimate than they are, okay? If they're saying this study says, I wanna see the study, okay? Otherwise, they're just kind of trying to trick you into thinking they're legitimate. All right, let's do one more. The number 9 most shared health article in 2018, okay? Not quite as many shares, but still. This one was published on time.com by Markham Hyde, all right? It's off to a better start already because I recognize the source, time.com, okay? They're known for doing news, sure. Cold and flu season, how do you tell the cold versus the flu? Let's see what Markham Hyde has to say. Does Markham Hyde say anything? What's the first thing he does? He cites an expert, Dr. Bruce Barrett. Who is Dr. Bruce Barrett? Does he have a medical license? How do you know?
You can look it up.
Exactly. Where do I go? It's on the handout. Okay. Let's see what else. All right. A lot of quotes. Another quote here. Who is it? A doctor. So far, Markham hasn't said very much. Markham's linking to other bits of information, okay? Markham's not a doctor, but he's quoting people who are. He links to the CDC even. There's even contact information to contact the Times Editorial Review Board to learn more or to point out errors, okay? So, do you think this article was ranked not credible and potentially harmful? Not credible? Neutral? Credible? Highly credible. What do you think? Highly credible, exactly, yes. Because what did he do? He pointed to experts, he cited his sources. All right, so I realize there's a lot to think about, okay? There's a lot to look at and a lot to keep in mind when you're reading about healthcare and trying to make the best decision for you. So here are the main things that I want you to keep in mind, okay? Be skeptical of clickbait headlines, okay? They want to wow you, all right? Because if you say, oh man, wow, I didn't know that eating 12 apricot seeds every day could cure cancer, let me click on that. Every single click is a little bit of ad revenue, okay? So it's in their best interest to be as shocking as possible. So be skeptical when you see something that makes you go, oh wow, geez, is that true? Use your best judgment, okay? If you're coming across something that has been shared a lot, like one of those articles we looked at that has more than 600,000 shares, click through and look for the original poster, all right? Is it coming from a doctor? Is it coming from a nonprofit organization? Who is the original poster? Look and see who actually wrote that information that you're looking at. Click through to the original source and evaluate, okay? Same deal. Look at who this information's coming from. Use the CRAAP test. Okay, evaluate using the CRAAP test. If you can't remember CRAAP, look at where this information's coming from. Website and author, okay? Is it a .gov, is it a .edu? .coms are often fine, but you just gotta do a little bit more work because they're not held to the same standard that .govs and .edus are. All right, the date, is this current or is this old news? Does it cite sources? Does it cite research? And then why are they telling me this? Do they want me to buy something? Do they want me to be afraid? Or do they want me to be healthy? Do they want me to be informed? All right, and then the biggest thing you can do when you come across something that makes you go, wow, I didn't know that, or gee, is that true, or wow, I think I'm gonna do this, double check the facts and verify with a second source. Okay, does it line up with stuff that you maybe heard before? Did your doctor mention it? Are they citing a source where you can go and look? Can you go on Medline Plus and it's matching up with what you're seeing? Okay? So, I know we hit you with a lot of stuff today. So here are some accurate, reliable resources for general health. You're gonna go to Medline Plus, the CDC, and Mayo Clinic. All of these are on your handout, by the way. For complementary and alternative medicines, Sloan Kettering has a really good, really extensive website. Of course, the NCCIH, the National Cancer Institute. All right, and all of these resources come from Medical Library Association's Consumer and Patient Health Information Task Force. So it's their job to come up with good resources for you guys. And then for drug information, we didn't really get a chance to go into that a lot today. I can if you guys want. Obviously, the FDA. The FDA actually has a consumer's page that's just for, everyday users who want to keep up on health news, want to find a little bit more generic information. It's not going to be so heavy laden with a lot of medical jargon or technical language. And then the National Library of Medicine has a really cool drug information portal. It's a lot like Pillbox. These two websites are similar in that you can look up what medication you're taking. It'll show you a picture. It'll tell you the side effects. It'll tell you possible interactions. So these are also on your handout. Don't feel like you have to memorize all of these.
All right, thank you, everybody.